The not-for-profit sector and the organisations that work within it provide a vital part of our community. They support those in need, they serve their local and global and international communities, and they shape nations. Without not-for-profits, we would only have the commercial sector, which of course does important things, but we would be lacking the lifeblood of our communities, which is the not-for-profit sector. From local clubs to international charities, they provide a real counterbalance to pure commercialism. And a lot of our society interactions rest in the work of these great organisations, which is why at McCrindle we put so much resource and effort and thought into one of our big set pieces, which is around understanding the future of the not-for-profit sector. And so joining me today to discuss the insights from our latest report that explores how, where, and why people are giving to charities and not-for-profits is Sophie Renton, a key author of that report and McCrindle's Managing Director. Hello, Sophie Renton.
Hello, Ashley Fell.
Delighted to have you on the podcast again. We have been chatting a lot about these insights within the office, within virtual events, within presentations for some of our not-for-profit clients who we have the privilege of working alongside. I actually believe, in addition to recording this podcast today, you and I have both been speaking to some pretty big not-for-profits. So it's really, I guess, on our hearts and our minds in terms of some of the issues facing these organizations. And we have discussed that in another episode of the podcast. But in today's episode, I'm really excited to hear a bit about just the not-for-profit landscape and what proportion of Australian people engage with not-for-profits, what their giving behavior is like. It's quite fascinating. Well, I mean, it's fascinating to us anyway. So that's what we're going to talk about. So how would you go about, if someone said, what's the lay of the land? What are people doing in Australia? What proportion are kind of engaged with not-for-profits or charities? What kind of insights would you have from this latest study to talk about?
Great question. And one that we do actually get asked a lot of times by people as they want to understand how they engage with donors. And I think one of the things that is really positive about the Australian not-for-profit landscape and donations and engagement is that 84% of Australians give financially to charities or not-for-profits. That's significant. That is, you know, more than 4 in 5 people in Australia will give in some way, shape or form to a charity or not-for-profit. And 75% give at least annually. So they give at least once a year. So it's not just I've given once in my life and I've moved on, but it's part of their habit of giving. And that's 75% giving at least annually. But then there's a significant proportion that are giving monthly, they're giving in a committed or a regular fashion. The heart of generosity in the Australian spirit is really strong. It's gone through challenges with COVID. The way of engaging is shifting, but the heart is still strong.
Yeah, I think that's really encouraging to see that more than eight in 10 people give financially to charities and not-for-profits. So well done to all our listeners. If you're out there, it's really important work, and maybe it's really committed and regular, or maybe it's more sporadic. And we're going to talk about that in a minute as well. But yeah, just remember, if you're listening and you're giving, you know, it's making a big difference. So well done for those among us. I think it's fascinating, you know, it's encouraging to hear that there's such a high proportion of Australians who are generous in this way. But we wanted to delve deeper into, I guess, the causes as well that people are giving to. And, you know, I think all the listeners know I've been working at McCrindle for 10 years. We did a whole episode about it. But, you know, I think like this piece of research was around when I first started in quite a different form. It's got a lot more sophisticated since you got involved, Soph, with it. But I think I remember learning about this like when I first started and hearing about the different causes. And it's always really interesting to see what's resonating with people. And in this report, we were able to have some of that, what we call longitudinal analysis, so we could see what causes have increased and decreased over time. And it's interesting to pinpoint and reason why that is. But so at the beginning of 2024, where is, not the priority, but what are people most likely to say they're motivated to give to in terms of the type of causes?
So the top type of cause that people are motivated to give to this year is children's charities, and that has remained consistent in the top three basically since we started asking this question in this way, which was in 2017. So we've got quite a few years of data behind that now, and the children's charity has always been, I guess, a top performer in those top three. What's really interesting, though, is that second place has come in for the first time to the top three, and that is mental health. So mental health has been doing a really big jump over the past few years as a type of or a charity or a cause that works in that area that people are really motivated to support. And then that's followed by homelessness, which is also making its way into the top three for just the second time. So it's been there before, but only once. So it's not a kind of long-term placeholder in that top three. And then interestingly, animal welfare and wildlife support, which has typically been in that top three, is at number four, followed by medical and cancer research, which has also been one that has, been a consistent high achiever because everyone has someone that they know that has been impacted by cancer in some way, shape or form.
Yeah, so that's interesting.
Those are the top ones.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing to see, as you mentioned, like children's charities there just has consistently been a cause that people are motivated to support, mental health rising, and we know that that has been driven by younger generations. I believe from some of the insights from this report that support for mental health has grown from 29% in 2017 to 42% today. Would you say that it's really the younger generations that are driving the motivation or this cause among the research?
Yeah, Gen Z is definitely driving this, with more than half of Gen Z highly motivated to give financially or volunteer for an organisation associated with mental health. And what we often see is that people are giving to causes that maybe align with their life stage or what's been topical in their conversations. So for Gen Z, they've really grown up talking about mental health more so than other generations, whereas for our baby boomers, medical and cancer research is often a little bit more prevalent in that age group. We see Gen Y is really motivated to support children's charities because they're often in their family forming years, they've got young kids, and they're trying to bring their kids along on that donation journey. So the life stage is a key factor in where people are choosing to give to, but also what's top of mind. I think what was really interesting was when we did this study in 2020, we had one of the highest responses was domestic or disaster relief within Australia. And if you cast your mind back to 2020 in January, that was when we had the Australian bushfires. So it was topical. It was, an easy give and an easy response. So often what has been communicated a lot in the media landscape or in community conversations, that does often impact where people are motivated to give because they want to give to the need.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes sense in terms of what's getting coverage in the news and the media, as well as what's relevant for different life stages and experiences. And it's interesting, within the report, we have this line graph over time. I mean, just sidebar note for a second, of course, I imagine people who've worked in research or done a uni assignment or whatever know that there are different ways of displaying different insights. And this one, you know, a line graph is so interesting to display trends over time because you can see just visually when something spikes or when something decreases. And so, yeah, that was what stood out to me as well, even in that graph that we've got in the report, where disaster and response in Australia like really spiked up in 2020 and then kind of dropped pretty severely after that, in those, as you mentioned, seasons of particularly bushfires that were pretty bad here in Australia and in some places in the US. And yeah, there's interesting. I mean, we talk and you talked about the rankings and some of the changes, but even over time, the other one that's interesting that stands out to me as I look is even the increase in motivation to support domestic and family violence, which has had a bit of a steady increase over the last few years. So yeah, we're not lucky because it was very intentional, but grateful to have been running this question. And that's the beauty of running the same question over time, is that you can accurately compare how things change, which is really fascinating. And I imagine every charity and every leader of different charities have got and keen interest in their cause and how that changes over time. I mean, is this, I always find this one really interesting, Soph. Is this one that you look forward to, particularly in terms of seeing if there's been any changes and trying to correlate those changes to certain trends?
Yeah, I find it so fascinating. Like the domestic and family violence one you mentioned, you can see that that really starts to take a rise after 2020 in terms of the prevalence of people looking to support it. And that was in our post-lockdowns, and it was a really keen topic of conversation during that time. And the team will remember this, the day that I was analysing this data, I was sitting and I was like, oh my gosh, the top three has changed. And I was like, guys, I'm just so excited, I need to tell you. And I'm like interrupting all of these people's, you know, really deep, thoughtful workflow, because I'm like, I just need to tell you that they've changed, because I've been doing this data and analysing this for so many years, and I've not seen it shift this much in 1 year to have the top three, to have two of the top three different for kind of the first time. So yes, it is one in my very nerdy way that I find exciting to see.
Yeah, that's a great point that you mentioned. I can see that on the graph that I have open, as you mentioned, with all the different lines and different colours representing different causes. 2020 with domestic and family violence, it shot up. And not in the same way, but even mental health kind of had a real uptake after 2020. So, yeah, fascinating, to see and to reflect on. I mean, 2020 was a really iconic year, which we don't need to talk about too much. We all know why. But, yeah, in terms of seeing a correlation in where people's attention is or awareness of different causes based on what's going on in the world around them is quite interesting. The other aspect of this report that I find really interesting is exploring how people give and how that's changed over time. We talk about giving and I guess grouping people into kind of two different ways of giving. One is opportunity givers and one is committed givers. So if, can you explain the difference between what an opportunity giver is and what a committed giver is and what proportion Australians kind of fit into in terms of those two categories?
Yeah, so the opportunity givers comprise the greatest proportion of Australian donors. So there's 58% that fit into an opportunity giver category, which is made up of those who give when they hear about a need or an issue, or when they are approached for a donation or support. So those that are giving when they hear about a need is 38%, and those that are giving when they're approached for a donation or support is 20%. And so that's 58% comprise the opportunity givers, whereas 42% sit in that committed giver category, with 30% giving semi-regularly throughout the year and 13% giving on a frequent or a regular basis. So what's interesting is that maybe historically people would have thought the majority of people who give to a charity or not-for-profit would have been in that frequent, regular basis or semi-regularly throughout the year. But what we have been able to track over time is really the opportunity givers and how that has shifted and grown in some ways, but maybe starting to see a shift back the other way, but we'll get to that soon. But what is interesting is that the younger givers are the ones that are driving the opportunity giving more. They're more likely to respond on a needs-based approach than committed to one singular organization. Our older generations, like our baby boomers, however, are more likely to maintain that consistency throughout the year with a few organizations and be very committed to them. I think one of the moments that we saw this most was in the bushfires. In that same year of the data that we collected, we can see that the top causes, there was that disaster response in Australia, but the people who gave when they heard about a need or an issue spiked to the highest point that it has been. And then it has started to, you know, drop back down to be where it was over more of that longer term trend. But yeah, the more years of data you get, the more it's really interesting to be able to recognize what are those external factors that are actually impacting giving behavior in a significant way.
And I imagine for someone listening who works in a not-for-profit, hearing that committed givers comprise less than half is a challenge, right? In terms of like the goal for a chief marketing officer or anyone working in not-for-profit is like, we want committed givers, we want stable income, we need regular donations to be able to keep doing the work, running the campaigns, helping out in the field, whatever that looks like, whatever cause they're helping. And then to hear that the rise of the opportunity giver, with the emerging generations being more likely to give when they hear about a need or issue or approach rather than that consistent regular support, is a challenge. Would you agree, Soph, that you, from the charities and the leaders that you speak to, that this is a challenge they're facing in terms of, not that it's just people are giving differently, but it's the reality is that it does provide a bit of a challenge for organisations who rely on donations and regular, generosity of people.
Oh, it's a significant challenge for so many different organisations that we're speaking to, because they're having this wrestle of, do they spend their limited resources on, you know, a smaller proportion of high value givers who are maybe in their older generation. Excuse me. Thanks, listeners. That smaller proportion of committed high value givers, or do they engage maybe a greater proportion of smaller givers of that younger generation who are giving in that need response way? And there are risks associated with each, because if you solely focus on an older giving demographic who commits regularly and committed, there is a point where they may not be able to fund your mission anymore. So to future-proof, you need to think about how you engage this next generation of donors, but you don't want to shift everything you're doing to engage them in such a way that you actually kind of disconnect your regular giving base. And so it's this real tension, as you know, we love talking about the word tension on this podcast. It's a real tension to manage, not a problem to solve, but a tension to manage around how you engage each of the generations to ensure sustainability for your organization.
Yeah, it's something that, like, it's just been so highlighted to me over the last few weeks, because we've had the research come through, which is not like shocking to us, because we've been tracking how people give and how people are motivated to give over time. So it's not like this is just a new shock trend, like, you know, it's been trending that way. But then, yeah, just been chatting to a few leaders in not-for-profit organizations and hearing, I guess, like, we see this from the research, and for us, because we're not a not-for-profit, like, we connect, we give, we serve them in different capacities in our personal lives, and as an organization we engage with not-for-profits. But in terms of, like, for people who are working in this day in and day out and thinking about the people they serve or the communities they serve, which is why they're all there and working for those organizations. Just hearing how much of a challenge it is, and at that point where they have limited resources and they're just held in such high accountability, which is so appropriate. But in terms of, like, if a campaign doesn't work, they've got pretty big questions to kind of answer to, or people going, well, why was my hard-earned taxpayer money not stewarded in the correct way or not in a strategic way? So we're hopeful that these insights and this research will be able to provide a realistic and informed picture, I think, of these younger donors particularly, and the importance of thinking about them, like you said, the tension of not leaving behind those really loyal, really amazing older generations who've been committed givers, but actually think about how you can A, engage opportunity givers, and B, hopefully turn them into committed givers who have bought into your cause and organization. We've also seen that move away from loyalty, I think, to institutions or organizations and focus on the cause, which also provides a bit of a contextual challenge as well. But Soph, do you have any particular, like, if a not-for-profit leader, which this is like a daily occurrence, I think, in terms of, like, we do get engaged to go and speak to boards of not-for-profit organizations where they're like, oh, how, like, any advice, any big picture, overarching things to keep in mind in terms of riding out that tension or managing that, what comes to mind for you when you're giving that kind of advice to someone working within the not-for-profit sector?
Yeah, I would say that there is maybe some light on the horizon. As we've said, we've been tracking some of this data for quite a few years. And when we look at the proportion of Gen Z who were committed givers in 2019, that just made up 23%. So just shy of 1 in 4 gave in a committed fashion. And they've been the ones that have been really driving the opportunity giving. But what we're seeing is as Gen Z are aging, so the oldest is now 29, they've been in their careers for a while, some have kids, that committed giving has grown to 35%. So it is, we are seeing maybe a slight shift start to occur in the Gen Z giving behavior as they shift into a different life stage. It'll be interesting to track it over time to see, does this continue? But I think what is really interesting when we look at this next generation is that 37% of Gen Z actually give at least monthly, and 36% have donated at least $200 in the last year. And you compare that to a baby boomer where 30% have given at least monthly and 31% have donated at least $200 in the last year. So actually, Gen Zs are more likely to give at least monthly and they are more likely to have donated at least $200 in the last year. Now, your Gen X and your Gen Ys who have more economic power behind them are the ones that are more likely to, a greater proportion have donated more than $200. So we've still got to understand the life stage that Gen Z is at. But their indicators are looking promising around their level of generosity and their consistency in generosity. I think what the challenge is that Gen Z are consistent in giving, but they're just not giving consistently to one organization. So say if you think about 12 months throughout the year, historically, maybe a charity got all 12 of those months of giving, or maybe 6 months of those giving, whereas Gen Z now might be just doing 12 different organizations, but 1 month each. And so it can give this perception to a charity that Gen Z are less generous, but it's not necessarily that they're less generous, they're just less loyal to one organization. So each charity is getting maybe a smaller piece of the pie, but the generation itself is still generous. So I think that then leans into how do you engage them in your cause? How do you help them? How do you empower them to advocate and amplify your message? How easy do you make it to engage with that, with your organization? And then I guess the other side of the equation is actually sharing it bad? I know as a organizational leader, you've got a bottom line and you've got impacts that you want to make. But understanding this next generation and the mindset that they bring, it might be a challenging journey to lock them into just a few organizations. So how can you work with that as well?
It's great to end on some hope there, because I think, as I mentioned, like I can understand that it's a hard landscape for leaders in the not-for-profit sector who rely on donations and they're being spread more thin. But like you said, there's the other side of that, the flip side, the positive is that there are more causes and they want to spread that generosity around, which hopefully benefits more people and more vulnerable people in those vulnerable communities. So really, really rewarding research that we get to do, and we love to see it fleshed out with organizations and then wrestling with it. And we hope that it does provide some, in equal measure, some challenging, truthful, truths, and then some optimistic, hopeful aspects around the future of the not-for-profit sector, the future of giving and volunteering. And like I mentioned at the top of the episode, we know and we believe that charities do some really important work, and without them, we would be far less off just as a society in general, but also the communities they work to serve. So thank you so much, Soph, for investing in this great research and for doing so for so many years and stewarding that really well, and for your time on the podcast today.
Thanks, Ash. Always a delight.
If you would like to stay up to date with some of this latest not-for-profit research, you can always head to our McCrindle website. In the resources section of the website, you'll find infographic summaries and reports there as well. And as always, just in terms of staying up with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.